Hello and welcome back to another session. This week I want to talk with you about algae, and it is one of those things that has a really horrible reputation, even though it does a lot for us. So just to name a few things that algae does incredibly well is growing. So if you look at macroalgae, which means big growing algae. For example, kelp, it grows faster and pretty big, so it can be like 20 meters long. So algae is not always the small slimy stuff. Also, algae, even though we don't think about it that much, it does produce the vast majority of the oxygen we all breathe every single day. So if you include phytoplankton, which means plant-based plankton, into your picture of algae all around, then you end up with about 60% of all the oxygen we all on this entire planet breathe every day being made by those specific algae. Now, that alone is in itself quite a good reason to take good care of our algae. But aside from that, there's a lot more to it. Phytoplankton did get a bit of a crappy reputation in this year at the very latest, but probably already in the years before, since it is also what we all know as algae bloom.
In Turkey, a slimy, floating mass of yellowish-white sea slime is threatening marine life and the fishing industry, especially in the Sea of Marmara and the waters south of Istanbul. But it's also in the Black Sea and the Aegean Sea, the so-called sea snot. It is caused by poor waste management, helped along by rising water temperatures due to global warming. The Turkish government recently launched an action plan to clean up the slimy substance. Many say the efforts come too late.
So when we talk about an algal bloom, as it is happening in many parts in Europe right now, basically what it is, it's an explosive growth of phytoplankton. So again, microscopic, small, single-celled organisms that can grow incredibly fast if the circumstances are right. Circumstances being enough nutrition and warm water. So that's basically it. So with us dumping our sewage into the sea, there's plenty of nutrients, and with, well, the sea constantly warming up, there's obviously plenty of warm water. So that in combination leads to an incredible strong growth of phytoplankton, and that's what we now call sea snot. But that's just what happened. The other thing is, most of us think of algae as something nasty, not nice. So I remember when I was a kid, I was told if there's a lot of algae somewhere, then there's something off with the ecosystem. It's not healthy, there's too many nutrients, there's too little nutrients, there's something wrong anyways. The truth though is that algae are an incredibly important part of the marine ecosystem. So we did talk about seagrass before, which is a breeding ground and like a nursing home for many creatures. Algae does fairly much the same. So we used to have, for example, cystocera, which is a very tall growing macroalgae that we have in the Mediterranean as well. And that basically vanished in the last couple of years. Nobody really could tell me now, until now, why exactly that is. But the fact is that we lost it for the most part. This also creates an incredible habitat for juvenile fish, for hunting, for crabs. Like if you take one algae and you actually look at it under binoculars, under a microscope, you will find hundreds of other species that live in the algae. Be it small crustaceans, be it small snails, all sorts of animals that live in this habitat. And of course, whenever there's small critters living somewhere, there's bigger animals that feed off those. So there's lots of mostly labradae, lipfish, that like to snack off all the animals that live in the algae. and they basically move around very fine-tuned in the algae petal and then defeat off all those little animals. So yet another reason why algae is important. Those things that algae actually produces itself are these omega-3 acids. Everybody talks about them when they eat fish, because fish is healthy because of those omega-3 acids. Truth is, fish cannot produce them. They simply steal them from the algae they feed on, or steal it from the fish that fed on the algae that makes them. So bottom line is, the algae is making all the healthy stuff that we seek from the fish. So instead of eating the fish, you could actually just eat the algae. And actually, algae did make it into our diet quite a while ago by now. So most of you will probably know that sushi is usually wrapped in nori. Nori is nothing else but an algae. So that's the first one. More and more we see superfoods in the shelves of different pharmacy markets. And one of the common ones is, for example, ulva. So ULVA. And ulva is nothing else but an algae. So it's a green algae, means it needs a lot of light, and it grows incredibly fast, very thin, so easy to dry. And when you grind it up, you have all the healthy stuff that we love from the aquatic marine animals in a very easy to carry, very easy to keep powder that you can just add to your food. And now we call it superfood, and all of a sudden it's a cool hip thing that costs a lot of money. But bottom line is, it's just an algae. Algae do need light. They are not, strictly speaking, plants as we know them, so not like seagrass in that way, because of the way they do produce, because of the way they run photosynthesis mechanisms. So all the plants we know, and seagrass as well, they are actual plants. So they have a certain kind of chlorophyll, and algae use a different kind. Doesn't really matter which one at this point, but it just means that the mechanics of the photosynthesis run a little bit different. That also means that algae, some kinds of algae, get away with a lot less light than, for example, seagrass. That's why we separate the algae in red, green, and brown algae. And as you have RGB, red, green, brown, basically working away from the bottom up. So red algae are the ones that can deal with very little light. So those you can actually find to depth beyond 200 meters, and also inside caves where there is very little light. Green algae are somewhere in the middle, so they can come down to maybe 20, 30 meters, but they need sufficient light anyways. And obviously there's no limit for them in theory, so they can deal with a lot of light as well. But other algae and other things do grow faster, so it's really just a competition that keeps them low in the water. And ultimately brown algae are the ones that need the most light, and therefore they live in the shallowest water. Now, the thing you have to keep in mind for any algae, any plant, any sessile animal though, is that they do not get to choose where they want to live. So basically, as an algae is born, so to speak, it is in a plankton. And then at some point it gets washed up somewhere on something solid, and it just starts to grow. And then either it manages to survive or it dies. If it's in just the right depth, with plenty of light or too much light, it will be fine, unless something else lands nearby that grows fast and will just grow over it, which does happen to the vast majority of babies, actually. But they do find their niche, and that's where they will survive and will strive. So that's just one of many cool things about algae. One thing we should definitely not forget anytime again, ever in the future, is algae is the stuff that uses the air that we breathe. Doesn't matter where on the planet you live, part of it comes from the sea, even if you live hundreds of kilometers away, like in Austria. The other thing we should not forget is, even though the reputation of algae is sometimes really, really bad, as in times of sea snot, algae is incredible stuff. And there's only certain mechanics that work towards, well, basically a very unfortunate development of things when it comes to the growth of algae. So too much intrusion, too much warm water. Yes, we did have a nasty algae bloom, and that simply is not a good thing, because it can wipe out lots of life in the marine environment in one go. And nobody wants that, let's be fair. But fact also is it did happen, and the reason why it happened is mostly our own mess. So if it wasn't for millions of people basically dumping their sewage into the sea in that very confined area, those things would not happen. If it wasn't for the water being so incredibly warm this year, and we recorded more than 30 degrees centigrade in the Adriatic Sea this year, which is unheard of. I don't know if it has ever been this warm, but not anywhere in the times that I've been around, I'm sure. So all those things do benefit this rapid growth of phytoplankton, which is nothing else than a microscopic little algae. So next time you hear about algae, doesn't matter if it's in sushi as a superfood, as sea snot, as anything else, just think about it twice. Maybe have another thought about it afterwards, and then make your judgment. Because bottom line is, we all do need algae. Doesn't matter if it's as food, for the air that we breathe, or just to look at, because we love watching those tiny little fish. So I hope you managed to learn a little bit more this time. Please check back in with us in 2 weeks when the next video of that kind will come out. And until then, if you want to see more of all the things that we're doing in more or less real time, we are right now in Messina. So we've made it to Sicily by now, and our school workshops will kick off next week. So make sure to check in on the other social medias like Instagram and have a look. Until then, see you next time. Bye.